Good day, everybody. My name is Marlene Hartman. I'm currently permanently employed by Meraka Institute of the Council of Science and Industrial Research, the CSIR, in South Africa. I'm chairperson of the Living Lab in Southern African Network, where we have 9 operational living labs, 2 of them focus on mobile health, and the others on other community-based services and products that they have developed. The purpose of this presentation today is to share with you what living labs are and how they can support innovation, and especially also the mitigation of risk related to health in rural communities where we have the operational living labs in South Africa. Good day, everybody. I am Marlene Hartman from the CSIR. I work for the Meraka Institute at the Council of Science and Industrial Research, where I'm also a research group leader of living labs, and the LISA chairperson, that is the Living Lab in Southern African Network, where we focus a lot on research being done on living labs, and we also have 9 operational living labs in our network. So we have about 5 years of experience of working with living labs in Southern Africa, but also in other parts of the world, especially with the European network of living labs. And the purpose of today's presentation is to share with you elements of a living lab, what it is, how it can add value to a community, also to show how a living lab concept or methodology or approach can assist in mitigating risk when it comes to health-related or spatial health-related problems. I have a few examples I will share with you. I will also tell you more about the Living Lab in Southern Africa Network so you can get an idea of what we're doing and why we're doing it. And I hope that you will enjoy this presentation. And if there's any other questions, please contact me at the end of the slides. I have my contact number and email address if you would like to get hold of me and have further discussions. If one wants to explain the key elements of the Living Lab, it is obvious from this slide that you can see the whole innovative process from the idea generation, which then in the middle of the blue one at the top involves the innovation stakeholders being grounded in a realistic setting, like a community for instance, or in an urban community as well. Research the underlying principles, and then you test and evaluate your ideas, and then you have a breakthrough. One can also see from the slide that within a living lab, the key elements that should be there is the fact that you have the user driving the whole process. Therefore, they talk about co-creation. So the user is driving the process of innovation and co-creating a new service or a product. It should take place in a real-life context. It must be in multidisciplinary, therefore involving different teams, looking at the problem from different perspectives, based on the stakeholders involved, also cover different domains and themes. It has an impact on the community to improve, and obviously also involves different stakeholders. It's supported by a specific funder or stakeholder, and you should also identify a unique set of values with different approaches when you want to do your living lab with your different stakeholders involved. The little blue one, which is Helsinki Living Lab, shows you the difference between the user in the middle, user-centric, versus user-driven, where the user is also driving the process as a stakeholder to create a new service or a new product. In the fourth slide, it is obvious that the Living Lab can be used to create new products with the community members and with different stakeholders. On the one side, you have the input. It can be a new idea, a new concept on the left. And on the other side of this figure, you have the results, which is a new product or a new service. In the middle is the Living Lab, where the new product and service is co-created with different stakeholders with their different methods and tools. And in the end, you will have a product that has a combined creation of everybody's inputs in order to then be able to be used in specific contexts. This slide supports the creation of innovation, where you have your two kidneys on the side. In the middle, you have the exploration. You have the experimentation, the evaluation, and the co-creation. Because you have sometimes the market push and then the market pull, where user communities want to use different innovations or different products and services. And in the middle is where the Living Lab support all the use scenarios, all the assessment scenarios, the exploitation and application scenarios. So in the end, you can see that this is a very good example of how Living Labs can support the creation of new innovation, and also through a technology platform in the middle, you can increase your knowledge. This shows, slide 6, shows you the example of how Living Labs can be used as a methodology. We have at the top the user involvement, whether it's from enthusiasts, early adopters, early majority, mainstream users, or on the green bar, the fundamental research, applied research, the different types of research applicable to the Living Lab. And in the middle, you have the Living Lab, which is user-driven open innovation involving all different players on the value network. And that is the action space where the Living Labs are operational within the methodology. At the bottom also you have the private and public research funding or industry or whoever is your funding mechanism. And they also have a say, but the Living Lab operates in the middle then between the users and the different research methodologies that you can apply. If you want to get a very good example to see where the Living Lab fits in regarding the in-house research and development, the open innovation platforms and the pilots, you can see in the middle where the red arrow is showing, or the red circle shows you where the Living Lab is operational between the in-house and the pilots. And it also determines the maturity of the project and the focus of it. And also you have a different societal innovation marketing data, real-life, real-time co-designing and testing, technical tests, small-scale testing, and lab development that are functional within this Living Lab space. This acts as an example of how the ubiquitous web have been developed with a context, within a specific context, and you can see the context here is an urban community, and the urban environment acts as the innovation platform for the ubiquitous internet, where they have applied urban mobile services, local social networking with a mobile device, experience, shopping, tourism, health, well-being, government, culture, education, entertainment, all those different bullets are operational within this example, which took place within Europe, in a specific in Amsterdam, where they wanted to support the health and well-being of people in a close vicinity. You can see the involvement of Google Maps there, the involvement of the mobile phone, the social network of Facebook, and everything working together in a mobile Living Lab environment to the benefit of the users in the end. And it also doesn't matter which type of mobile device you use, as long as you can integrate that into your specific system. And in this context of this presentation, for the purpose of this conference, it's obvious then that one can use this example to showcase how it can be operational in El Salvador, for instance, if you want to focus on mobile health, where you get the input and you also have the GIS maps available to support you with where people are located or where resources are located to mitigate the risk involved. This is another example which I've just added as an example for you to see how one can use the Living Lab in a different value chain of your business. We have the workshops in the yellow at the bottom together with the user-centric approach, the user involvement there, and how you can then work through the value chain and how the Living Lab can assist you in this regard. This is also an example which I've added, which was used in Finland, where it illustrates the involvement of Living Lab regarding the organization, the origin, the orientation, the role of the users, and technology used in two different Living Labs in Helsinki. I've added this slide to indicate to you how the user experience can be added as an interaction between the product, the context, the cultural factors, the social factors, and the user, in order to get a good user experience within your Living Lab, and therefore also the reason why to involve users in co-creating your new product or service. This is another example of how one can use, for instance, risk management as an option to mitigate the risk, where you have in the circle the red side showing to you exactly the mobile risk management through the mobile phone, device management application, private data protection, and mobile security. These are all examples that I've added in order to explain how the Living Lab can be used to mitigate the risk involved. This is also a nice exercise that we have done in order to understand the context of mobile health in the country in South Africa. You can see there's a lot of dimensions here, who has to pay, and in the blue at the bottom, the paper health, and how do we act with the mobile phone to take away all of the schlep regarding paperwork. And then also on the right-hand side, you can see the involvement of policy, who's involved, the phones, the type of phones involved. And this is a very nice plan to use, especially for El Salvador, if you want to determine where you want to go with your mobile health devices. There are different types of applications and mobile phones available. We know that Apple has a lot of applications, and there's also companies, mobile labs all over the world who are developing applications for mobile health. which can be used to mitigate the risk. And these are just a few examples that one can apply. This is the latest World Bank report, which indicates to one the impact of the mobile telephone regarding mobile health. I've left the URL at the top for you to go and download. It's a huge report and it will be valuable to read through this because it also applies to different other fields. I've focused here specifically on health, and you can also see the involvement there of mobile health service in the middle on the right hand side where the green circles are. You have to look at finance, technology, as well as your health situation, your system and your government on the side. And then on the left hand side of this slide, one can see the number of countries involved with at least one mHealth deployment by the World Bank region up to 2011. And this is very interesting statistics, and to see the influence that mobile health can have on countries in developing contexts. So this report is really valuable to go and have a further look at if you want to involve yourself with mobile health. I will now focus on the Living Lab in Southern Africa network to give you some idea of when we started, and we have non-operational Living Labs. We have different other Living Labs that are in the context phase. The multi-stakeholder involvement in the middle, you can see the government involvement, the research involvement, all the different universities involved in South Africa, in all our Living Labs. We also see in South Africa a huge involvement from a university perspective, because many universities see this as an opportunity to show community engagement. And therefore they work with NGOs or industry, or they work with civil society in order to support the development of ICT in communities and to help communities also with skills development. So the Living Lab is actually a very nice way to use, or a methodology or an approach to use when you want to involve different projects within communities. And this has been successfully done in our Living Lab in South Africa network. We also have different experience on different business models that they have used, on different services and products that they have applied. And all this is available on our website, which you will see in the end. It's also important for us in LISA, the Living Lab in South Africa network, to have defined our own definition of Living Labs within our context. And therefore we have developed a white paper, and you can see the definition there, where we see it as environments and methodology and approach to cater for user-driven. There's a real life or urban settings, rural or urban settings, you have different stakeholders involved. The second word, also successful deployment, is important in order to support service delivery or new business models. The third one, also then the leveraging the Living Lab methodologies and Living Lab networks to provide an important opportunity to collaborate, co-create, prototype and test new products and services, technologies, processes and business models, and also to support the developing markets. Therefore, the Living Lab is a perfect vehicle to use and to create and support the definition that we use in LISA. This slide provides an overview of the number of Living Labs operational already, and falls under the LISA network in Africa and also South Africa. You can see also the development in East Africa, which is very prominent to see. And this whole concept has been taken into Africa through the LISA network, as well as collaboration between Euro Africa ICT component. This provides an overview of the focus of the different Living Labs that are operational. You can see we have one in more or less every province in South Africa, and this is also a case study that we've done last year to determine what is the main purpose and process and deliverables of each Living Lab in this network. This provides an overview of the different focuses of innovation in the different Living Labs. You see there's learning, business, technology and social. We find that in this LISA network in South Africa, the focus is very prominently on social innovation, because they want to change the lives of communities, improve it and assist them to also assist themselves later on in future. Within this previous slide, this one is adding to this to the previous one, where the focus is then showing the network pattern, the supporting technologies and the challenges in each type of innovation. You can see that the one in the middle on social innovation has been highlighted to show that knowledge is the network pattern, and also the different methodologies that one apply within the social innovation to uplift the community. This is the last slide. I hope that I've provided you with a correct overview and an informative overview, so that you understand the concept of the Living Labs better. Also to see where it falls within or fits within your specific project or area of operation, and how it can also be an advantage to this whole project, which is the purpose of this conference in the end. And also to assist with the value of a living lab that it can add to a community from a social innovation perspective. At the end, I present to you the overview of our LISA board. You can also see they are representative of every aspect of the different stakeholders. And that is also important when you set up a living lab, that you have a true representation of all the stakeholders in your board, which should help you to guide priorities and establish new focus areas or new visions for yourself in the future. And in the end, I can say thank you for the opportunity. I hope you all enjoy the conference, and it was nice speaking to you, and I hope you get value out of this. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.